Okay, so the question that we're going to be doing is subarray with given XOR. And let's see what the question actually says. Okay, so we are given an array of random numbers and the range is between 1 to 10 to the power 9. And the thing is that we have to calculate the number of subarrays that after doing the XOR of the elements of the subarray, XOR of the subarray, so the resultant should be equals to K. So let me explain it one more time. Okay, so the thing is right here, as we can see, if we take this subarray, the resultant 4XOR2 is actually equals to 6, which is equals to K. And if we take this subarray 2XOR2XOR6, the resultant is also 6, which is actually equals to K. And if we take this subarray alone 6, this is also equivalent to 6. And if we take the XOR of the whole array, so 4XOR4 is going to cancel out itself, and 2XOR2XOR6, which is actually the whole array, so the resultant of this is also going to be 6. And as you can see, they are all actually equals to K. And the number of subarrays which are actually equals to K are 4. So we have to return this as the answer. The number of subarrays which are after doing the XOR of the elements is equals to 6. So this is the what the question is saying. And now let's see. Okay, so the brute force solution, like, you can figure that out for yourself, but I'm directly going to jump into the most optimal solution. So now, as we have to calculate the subarray, so the thing is that if we actually take the XOR of, let's say, this part of the subarray, then, like, if I ask you, like, what are the number of subarrays in this part, which is actually going to be equivalent to K? So, like, from the observation, we can see that this is actually equals to K, this part of the subarray. And the thing is that this part of the subarray is, let's see. So this, if you are going to XOR all the numbers of this part of the array, and this is actually equal to resultant of the K. So the thing is that if you are able to calculate what is this part, what is this part of the resultant, so you can actually calculate the number of subarray which are actually equivalent to K. So let me explain this. So this XOR resultant is actually constituted of Y part of the XOR and this K part of the A. So this XOR is actually made up of these two parts. So like, now if I ask you what is the Y? So the thing is that if you are able to calculate the Y, this part of the XOR, then the thing is you are actually calculating what are the number of subarrays which actually create the K. So let me do a dry run and explain this part one more time. So this is actually the equation. And what I asked is, you are already given the K part, and you are also given the XOR part. So XOR you are going to calculate after, let's call this as prefix XOR. So when you are at the 0th index, the XOR is 4. So now you are at this part. So 4 XOR 2 is actually 6, which is actually equal to our K. So we are going to consider this as our one count, because you founded a subarray which is actually equals to my count, which is actually equals to my K. So now you're going to move on further and you are going to XOR this 6 with 2 itself. So it is again going to be 4. And the thing is that when you come at this point in time, so you are going to XOR with 6, which is actually going to be resultant is going to be equals to 2. So now at this point in time, you know that the XOR of all of this part of the subarray is actually equals to 2. And now you already know what is the K. What is the K? You already know, which is 6. So if I write this equation as, let's say, doing XOR of K on both sides, then this equation is actually going to look like what? K XOR the resultant of this prefix part of the subarray, and Y XOR K, because we have actually doing XOR on both sides. And what is the XOR of this? This is going to get cancelled because that is the property of the XOR. And now this equation is actually going to look like, we have to calculate Y by using XOR we have calculated and the K we already got. So this is the resultant equation, and this part of the equation is now, let's see what it's going to look like, is Y is equals to 2 XOR 6, which is actually equals to 4. So what is this saying? So this is saying that we are going to check that if there exists a subarray whose XOR is actually equals to 4, and yes, there are actually two point in time that the XOR was actually 4. And what is this signifying is that, let's see, if I remove this, so this is signifying that this point in time, the resultant of this XOR was actually 2, which we have already stated. And the thing is that what is this 4 signifying is that there was this point in time that there was a Y, there exists a Y, and this part of the subarray was actually equals to K. Because that is the only possibility that this part of the subarray could be actually equals to 4. When this part of the subarray was actually my equals to K. And this equation that we have calculated was like to show that there was actually a point in time where my Y was actually equals to 4, and the resultant of this part of the subarray, if you do the XOR of this part of the subarray, it was actually equals to 6, and the whole resultant of this XOR was actually equals to 2, which is white here, because we are calculating this part, we are actually calculating the prefix XOR of all of the numbers. So now this was actually only 1 4, and there was also another occurrence of 4. So that means that there was another, let's see, we have already stated that this was 1,4, and the thing is that if you calculate this part of the subarray, this is also actually equals to my y, and this part of the subarray is also actually equals to k. So there were actually two times that there was an occurrence of 4, which was stating that there is a point in time when y was both the 4. And what this was actually signifying, that there was two occurrences of k, you know, there were two times that there was a subarray which was actually equivalent to k, which is actually true, because one time my k was this 6 alone, and one time this was my k. So there are actually two subarrays. It was saying that my was equal actually to this. So to actually include that in our count, we are going to say that this is actually equals to 3, because we have calculated that there were actually 3 occurrences of 6 at this point in time, including this one which was actually this, which we have calculated over here when we are doing prefix XOR. And finally, when we are at this point in time, so we are going to do XOR of 2, which we have already calculated, and this 4. So this is also actually equals to 6, which is actually also equals to my k. So this, my count is actually going to be equal to 4. So this was how we are calculating. So you have to do a dry run yourself actually, so to actually understand this concept. So now let's see how we are actually going to implement this, and how we are going to identify that there was actually this 2 occurrences. So let me state it again, 4 2 2 6 4. Okay, so 4 2 2 6 and 4. So this is my array, my k which we have to calculate is 6, and let's call it as XOR P, which is initially going to be 0, my count is also going to be 0, and let's start iterating. So at this point in time, I'm going to do the prefix XOR of this with 0, which is going to give me the result as 4. So now the thing is that I'm going to check, is my prefix XOR is actually equals to k or not. So at this point in time, it is not. So I'm going to check again. So is my XOR P is actually equals to my k or not? So if it is, then I'm simply going to increase my count. But if it's not, then what I'm going to do is, I have already calculated what is my equation. So y is equals to, but if I have to find a y, I have to check if my XOR, which I have calculated this, XOR my k, is there a y that actually exists? So where I should check my y, which is going to get calculated after using the XOR prefix and the k which I am actually given. So where I'm going to check that? So that is actually going to in my key value pair that I'm going to create. It is going to be in my map. And the thing is that, what is my y actually? So it is nothing but my prefix XOR that I'm calculating after all this time. So the thing is that initially I have to check map, I have to find this, and if I'm able to find this, then what I'm going to do is, I'm going to simply calculate this in my count. XOR 3 XOR K. And let's see. Okay, so I'm going to check, is my 4 XOR 6, does it exist in my map? No, because initially my map is actually empty. So I'm going to do nothing, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to put this prefix XOR in my map. Map of XOR prefix. And the thing is that I am going to increase my occurrence count of this. And you're going to see in a minute why. So I'm going to put this here, 4, and initiate my count as 1. And now I'm going to move forward and I'm going to do 4 XOR 2. So this is actually going to become as 6, because if you do the 4 XOR 2, it is going to be 6. So again, I'm going to check, is my XOR prefix is actually equals to K or not? So yes, it actually is. So I'm going to increase my count as 1. And then again, I'm going to check, is my 6 XOR K? So does it exist in my map? It is actually equal to 0. So no, it doesn't exist in my map. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to simply put this 6 in my map, which is the prefix XOR at this point. Now again, I'm going to go here and 6 XOR 2, it is actually again equals to 4. So I'm going to check, is my 4 actually equals to my K? No. Is my 4 XOR 6, which is actually equals to what? It is actually equals to 4100 and 110. So if I XOR this, it is actually equals to 2. So does 2 exist in my map or not? No, it doesn't exist. So I'm simply going to put my 4 again in my map. But here is the catch. It already exists there, so I'm going to increase my count of 4 to 2. So now, again, I'm going to move forward, and now finally, I'm going to do 4 XOR 6, which is actually equals to 2. And the thing is, again, I'm going to check, is my 2 equals to my K? No. And now here comes the magic of this equation. So the thing is, I've already said, we have to calculate Y using the XOR pre XOR K. So now the thing is that my XOR prefix is 2 and my this is 6. So the resultant Y which I'm going to get is actually 4. So my 4 actually does exist here. So what this actually means is that there is a point in time where my whole XOR is actually equals to 2, and there are occurrences of 4 2 times. There is a point in time where this part is actually equals to Y, and again this part is also equals to Y. So this is what this 4 and the count 2 is signifying. So it is saying that if this was the part where my Y was actually 4 2 times, then this is actually going also saying that there is also a point in time when there was 2 occurrences of my K. So that is what this count is actually saying. So if you are able to calculate the Y, you are actually calculating also the number of occurrences of K. So we are simply going to add this 2 in my count. So this time it was 1, so we are going to add 2 here. So this is going to become as 3. So this is how our equation is actually helping us. And finally, after doing all of this, I'm simply going to put my XOR, which I have calculated, in my map. So this 2 is actually going to come here, and I'm going to increase my count of it. So this is done, and finally I'm going to do XOR with 4. So the XOR of this 2 XOR 4 is actually 6. So now my XOR is 6, and this XOR, prefix XOR, is actually equals to my K. So again, I'm going to increase my count finally. So this is going to become 4. And again, I'm going to check, is my XOR, which is a 6, XOR K, which is also 6. So does 0 exist in my map? No. So I'm going to move forward and my put my, because it, the XOR I've calculated is 6, so I'm going to increase its count as 2. And finally, I'm out of bounds, and I'm going to return this count as my answer. So this is how we are going to solve this problem. And let's look at the code. Okay. Let's compare it. Okay. So I'm initializing my count as 0, my prefix XOR as also 0, which I have actually done initially right here. It was 0 here. And now I have already said that we are going to create a key value pair. And we are finally going to start iterating our array. So as soon as we are going to pick our array, we are going to calculate the prefix XOR by doing the prefix XOR with my element. And after that, we are going to check, is my prefix XOR is actually equals to K, which we are doing right here. And if it is, we are going to increase our count. And after that, we are going to check, is my map.find is actually able to use our equation prefix XOR and K. So if it is able to find my Y using this equation, then we are simply going to add the number of occurrences, of my Y in my count. So that is why the key value pair. And after that, we are going to increment the count of whatever the prefix XOR we have calculated, and we are going to put it in our map as the Y, which is we are going to use in the future using our equation. And that is how we are doing it again and again. And finally, we are going to return that in our count. And let's summarize this, what we have done. Okay. So now, okay. So if you want to find the number of subarray which after XOR makes K, so then we actually need to find how many Y subarrays are there which makes. So this equation which we have stated here is actually going to calculate. So is there a subarray Y that exists which after doing the XOR with K makes a prefix XOR or not? So a lot of words here. So this is what actually it is saying. So is there a my prefix XOR which after doing K XOR Y, so does it actually exist? So to actually found it, we have already calculated the prefix XOR, which we are going to calculate using that. So we are going to state the Y here and K XOR prefix XOR. So this is how we are going to find that. And using this, we are going to derive our equation. So how we are actually going to start? So we will start iterating our array, which we are doing this. And before that, we have to actually initialize our count as 0 and our prefix XOR as 0. And we will start iterating our array, and we are going to calculate prefix XOR by doing XOR with the current element, which we are doing right here. And after that, we are going to check, is my prefix XOR is actually equals to K? If yes, then we are increasing the count. And we are going to, after that, check in map, if my prefix XOR K makes a subarray Y previously or not. So this is the most important step here. And if yes, then it means that there exists a subarray that actually makes Y. And if we count them, we have calculated the number of K it can actually make. And we will also keep the count of that in map of how many times a prefix XOR occurred, which is in future is going to make the subarray Y. So you have to actually understand this and you have to dry run this a lot of times. So this is a little bit harder than the other questions. Even like I took a lot of time to understand this, and let's see the time complexity and space complexity of this. Okay, so as we are using the unordered map for this, so the space complexity is actually going to be big O n in the worst case, and the time complexity is because we are iterating our array, so it is actually going to be also time complexity big O n, and the space complexity is also big O n because we are using extra space of unordered map. And that's about it for this question.